Welcome back to my channel. Today we will discuss about femoral triangle. Femoral triangle is also referred to as Scarpa's triangle. It is a triangular depression in the upper one third of the front of thigh. We'll see what are its boundaries. So it has got a base, an apex which is directed downwards, a medial boundary and a lateral boundary, and also roof and floor. The medial boundary is formed by the medial border of the adductor longus muscle, whereas the lateral boundary is formed by the medial border of the sartorius muscle. The base is formed by the inguinal ligament. Inguinal ligament extends from the anterior superior iliac spine to the pubic tubercle. And the apex is formed by the meeting point of the adductor longus and the sartorius. So, I have said the medial boundary is formed by the medial border of adductor longus. So, based on the presence or absence of adductor longus, we can divide the femoral triangle into two triangles, that is anatomic triangle and geometric triangle. In anatomic triangle, we include the adductor longus. That means, in the anatomic triangle, the medial boundary is the medial border of the adductor longus. Whereas if it is geometric triangle, the medial boundary is the lateral border of the adductor longus. So usually we take only the anatomic triangle, that is the medial boundary is the medial border of the adductor longus. Now the roof is formed by the sphenic superficial fascia and the deep fascia. The deep fascia of the thigh is referred to as the fascia lata. The floor is formed by four muscles. From medial to lateral, it is adductor longus, then pectineus, then psoas major, and then iliacus. So the muscles from medial to lateral are adductor longus, pectineus, psoas major, and iliacus. In between the adductor longus and pectineus pass the profunda femoris vessels. In between the pectineus and the psoas major pass the medial circumflex femoral vessels, and in between the psoas and the iliacus pass the trunk of the femoral nerve. Now that's all about the boundaries of the femoral triangle. So it's a triangular depression in the upper one third of the front of thigh. Now we will see what are its contents. So as the name suggests, it's femoral triangle because it is related to femur. Most of the contents are named as femoral. So the main contents are the femoral vein and its tributaries, the femoral artery and its branches, the femoral nerve and its branches, then the another one is lateral cutaneous nerve of thigh, then femoral branch of genitofemoral nerve, and then there are deep inguinal lymph nodes. And also there is fibrofatty tissue. So these are the main contents of the femoral triangle. Now we will see what is femoral sheath. So the upper 3 to 4 cm of the femoral vessels, that is the femoral vein and the femoral artery, are enclosed within a sheath that is known as the femoral sheath. And this sheath is having an anterior layer and a posterior layer. So it is enclosing the femoral vessels. The anterior layer is known as the fascia transversalis, whereas the posterior layer is referred to as fascia iliaca. So the fascia transversalis is a continuation of the deepest layer of the anterior abdominal wall. And fascia iliaca, that is a posterior layer, it is the fascia covering the iliacus muscle. So that is the two layers forming the femoral sheath, that is enclosing upper 3 to 4 cm of the femoral vessels. The femoral nerve is not included within the femoral sheath because it is passing behind the fascia iliaca. So since this nerve is passing behind the fascia iliaca, it is not included in the femoral sheath. Now there are two septa, that is two anteroposterior septa, that divides the femoral sheath into three compartments. So the compartments are medial compartment, intermediate compartment, and the lateral compartment. The two anteroposterior septa divide the femoral sheath into three compartments. So the medialmost compartment is an empty space, and that is referred to as femoral canal. So middlemost compartment is the femoral canal. The intermediate compartment has the content that is femoral vein, whereas the lateral compartment, the contents are the femoral artery and the femoral branch of genitor femoral nerve. Now, what is the importance of the femoral canal? The femoral canal, since it's an empty space, it has got some lymph nodes, that is the deep inguinal lymph nodes of Clocket. And since it is an empty space, it provides space for the femoral vein for expansion during increased venous return. And it is also a most common area for the femoral hernia to occur. So that's all about the three important aspects of the femoral canal. Now, we'll see. So this is the region of the femoral canal. And the femoral canal, the upper boundary, upper part is formed by femoral ring. The upper part of the femoral canal is the femoral ring. So the femoral ring is bounded anteriorly by the inguinal ligament. So femoral ring is bounded anteriorly by the inguinal ligament. Posteriorly, there is pectineus muscle and its covering fascia. Medially, there is a lacunar ligament. And laterally, there is the femoral vein. Now, femoral hernia. You might have heard about femoral hernia. Femoral hernia is more common in females because they have got a wider femoral ring. Why they are having a wider femoral ring? Because the female pelvis has got greater breadth. And because of the greater breadth of the female pelvis, and also the diameter of the femoral vessels is narrow in case of females. So because of that, the femoral ring is wider. So the femoral canal is wider. Because of that, there is more chance of femoral hernia in females. That's all about the femoral canal and the femoral ring. And now the femoral ring is covered by a femoral septum, that is an extraperitoneal connective tissue. That's a femoral septum. And the septum is very thin. So the region above the septum, you have got a small depression that is known as the femoral fossa. So that's all of the femoral canal, femoral ring, femoral septum and the femoral fossa. Now you can see the femoral sheath is pierced by some structures laterally, anteriorly and medially. Laterally, the structure that is piercing, you can see here, one nerve is coming out, that is a femoral branch of the genitor femoral nerve that pierces laterally. Anteriorly, it is pierced by three superficial branches of the femoral artery. These are superficial circumflex iliac, superficial external pudendal and superficial epigastric arteries. So these three arteries, which are the three superficial branches of the femoral artery, pierce the femoral sheath anteriorly, and medially it is pierced by the great saphenous vein on its way to enter into the femoral vein. So these are the three structures, three different structures that pierce the femoral sheath. Okay. Now next we'll see what is the relationship of the saphenous opening to the femoral sheath. The saphenous opening is present. It has got mainly four margins, an upper, lateral, lower margin and also medial margin. So these upper, lateral and the lower margins are present in front of the femoral sheath, whereas the medial margin is present beneath the femoral sheath. And this saphenous opening is covered by the cribriform fascia. You know that it is covered by cribriform fascia. So you can say the anterior medial surface of the femoral sheath is related to the cribriform fascia. That is the relationship of the saphenous opening to the femoral sheath. Now we'll see what is the direction of the femoral hernia. So we said that it is more common in females. So the direction is, what is a femoral hernia actually? Femoral hernia, hernia means the protrusion of abdominal contents through any defect. So it can be protrusion of abdominal contents along with the spherical peritoneum. Here we have got a femoral ring. So the contents along the parietal peritoneum can come through the femoral ring to the femoral canal. So it is coming downwards and then forwards. So forwards, we told there is a relationship of the saphenous opening. So it can come forwards and then upwards to the inguinal ligament. So the direction is downwards, forwards and upwards. So in order to reduce the femoral hernia, you have to manually reduce it in the opposite direction. So since this is the direction of femoral hernia, we have to reduce this in the opposite direction. That is, if it is upwards, then it should be downwards, then backwards, and then upwards. So that is downwards, backwards, and upwards. Now, in case of strangulation of the femoral hernia, strangulation of the femoral hernia means the neck of the hernial sac can get strangulated at the region of the femoral ring. So for that, we have to cut the lacunar ligament, which is the medialmost boundary, so that that femoral ring is enlarged. So when we are cutting the lacunar ligament, you have to take care of the fact that there can be abnormal obturator artery. Sometimes abnormal obturator artery can be seen just medial to the lacunar ligament. So if you are not aware about that, and if you are cutting the lacunar ligament, there can be injury to the abnormal obturator artery, and that can lead to profuse bleeding. So if abnormal obturator artery is a lateral relationship, then it's fine, there won't be any bleeding because we are cutting the lacunar ligament, that is the medial boundary. If the abnormal obturator artery is medial to the lacunar ligament, you have to take care of the of that fact. So I told you the femoral vessels, which is enclosed in the femoral sheath, is passing beneath the inguinal ligament. This is because during movements of your hip joint, there can be chance of injury to the femoral vessels. So femoral sheath protects actually the femoral vessels in these movements. And in case of newborns, this femoral sheath is rudimentary, and because the newborns are having a universal flexion position. So because of that, the femoral sheath is rudimentary, but when they starts to walk, the thigh gets extended, and because of that, the femoral sheath also gets prolonged. So that's the importance of that. So when we palpate the femoral artery, the femoral artery is palpated at a point that is referred to as the mid-inguinal point. So mid-inguinal point means between the anterior superior iliac spine and the pubic symphysis. Okay. And there is another point that is referred to as the midpoint of inguinal ligament. So midpoint of inguinal ligament is between the anterior superior iliac spine and the pubic tubercle. So these two points are different points. The femoral artery is palpated at the mid-inguinal point. And next, we have discussed about the femoral hernia. Now, there can be inguinal hernia also. The inguinal hernia is the most common hernia, but in females the most common hernia is the femoral hernia. So how will you differentiate between the inguinal hernia and the femoral hernia with relation to the pubic tubercle? So this is a pubic tubercle. The femoral hernia is inferolateral to the pubic tubercle, whereas the inguinal hernia is supromedial to the pubic tubercle. So that's how you differentiate between these two hernias. Now, there is a point that is known as Butcher's thigh. So what do you mean by Butcher's thigh? I told you at the apex, the structure, the main contents pass through the apex. Now, if there is any injury to the apex, like a stab injury or bullet injury, many structures are pierced at that side. Butcher's thigh, the term refers because the butcher keeps his dagger suddenly, and it can lead to the injury to the femoral vessels and other structures related to that region. So the structures that are passing through the apex that is leading to this injury are medial femoral cutaneous nerve from above downwards. Okay, first is medial femoral cutaneous nerve, then femoral artery, femoral vein, adductor longus muscle, profunda femoris vein, and profunda femoris artery. So these are the structures that are injured in case of a stab injury at the apex. So this apex continues as the adductor canal. So we'll discuss adductor canal later. So the apex continues as the adductor canal, and these are the structures that are injured at the apex. Now, a lump in the groin is very important clinically. It can present with many differential diagnoses. So whenever a patient is presenting with a lump in the groin, you can think of any enlarged inguinal lymph nodes, It can be some subcutaneous tissue attachment, that is the lipoma. It can be aneurysm of the femoral artery, or it can be neuroma of the femoral nerve. Then it can also be some hematoma of the femoral vein due to venipuncture, or there can be dilatation of the Graves' saphenous vein. There can be either femoral hernia or inguinal hernia. Then there can also be ectopic testis in the femoral triangle. So those things you have to keep in mind when a patient is presenting with lump in the femoral triangle. And one more thing, femoral nerve after entering into the femoral triangle is dividing into two, that is anterior and posterior divisions, and between these two divisions pass the lateral circumflex femoral artery. So we have discussed about the boundaries, condensed, the femoral sheath and its compartments, the femoral canal, importance, femoral ring and its importance, femoral septum, fossa, then the femoral hernia, then the Butcher's thigh, the structures pierced at the apex in case of any stab injury, then the two triangles, the anatomic and geometric triangle. Then we have also discussed about the differential diagnosis of any lump in the groin. So that's all about the femoral triangle. It is a very important essay question. I hope you understood this topic. If you haven't subscribed to this channel, please subscribe and please press the bell icon to get more notifications. Thank you.